It's Sunday morning, and we're talking about the history of Israel. The history of Israel has to do with Christmas. It has to do with tongues. It has to do with the 70 weeks, and they're all related. Well, I've taught on that, hadn't I? I was flipping through the TV one night, and I got to give you something here. Very interesting. I saw the advertisement for The Walking Dead, and I got to thinking about that. They're called ghouls. So I went on the internet to look up ghoul. Everything goes back to the Christmas system that Israel was involved in when they were a nation for 500 years and they went after Baal and the grove. And I looked up ghoul. A ghoul, G-H-O-U-L, is a monster or evil spirit in Arabian mythology. Remember the Lord spoke of fables? To avoid these fables of men. Fable is the word muthos, it means myth. Associated with graveyards and consuming human flesh. Immediately when I think of human flesh, I'm thinking of cannibals, aren't you? And I'm thinking of eating the body of Christ. And I'm connecting all this as I'm thinking here, seeing that advertisement. Never have watched it, I thought it was goofy, but it illustrates a reality. The oldest surviving literature that mentions ghouls is likely 1001 Nights. The term was first used in English literature in 1786 in William Beckford's Orientalist novel, Vathek, which describes the ghoul of Arabian folklore. It goes back to the Arab countries, which goes back to Babylonian times. In modern fiction, the term has often been used for a certain kind of undead monster. By the extension, the word ghoul is also used in a derogatory sense to refer to a person who delights in macabre or whose profession is linked directly to death, such as gravedigger or grave robber. Ghoul is of the Arabic G-H-U-L or galah, G-H-A-L-A-H, meaning to seize. The term is etymologically related to galu, G-A-L-L-U, G-A-L-L-U, a Mesopotamian demon. Where's Mesopotamia? Mesopotamia between the rivers, that's down there in Babylon. And Babylon is the mother of all harlots, all idolatry. In ancient Arabian folklore, ghoul dwells in burial grounds and other uninhabited places. The ghoul is a fiendish type of genie. A genie is a demon. That's the same thing the Celts called fairies, and these were the gods of the ancient world, the gods, and the Jews called their ancestors D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N, Daimonion. And that word was the word for the gods or their ancestors. They deified their ancestors as the gods. Let me get back to this. A ghoul is also a desert-dwelling, shape-shifting started in the garden when Satan shifted himself into the body of a serpent. And in all the fire worship, you got shape-shifting. Merlin shifted his shape. Merlin and King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table are thinly veiled gods of the ancient world, sun and tree goddesses. Back to Christ's Mass, and the people that are coming here know what we're talking about. And they could shift their shapes into an animal. That's where you get werewolves. That's where you get vampires. They're supposed to shift their shape at the brightness of the moon, and they worship the Lord Moon, and that was Allah, or Alon, the tree god. To get into ghouls, you're getting into the same thing as Christmas. That the demon could have assumed the guise of an animal, especially a hyena. It lures unwary people into the desert wastes and abandoned places. Reminds me of Luke. I'll just read this right now. Luke, the 11th chapter. A 10th chapter. Luke. Look here. I see this in every phase of our society. In Luke 11, excuse me. Luke 11, I'm thinking of something else in 10. Luke 11, in verse 20, if I with the finger of God cast out devils, what does God do with his finger? He writes upon fleshy tables of our hearts. That word devils there is daemonion. He cast out the god of self. No doubt the kingdom of God has come upon you. When a strong man armed keepeth his palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him, overcome, by the way, is the word nikao. It's the verb form of victory. N-I-K-A-O. That's the word overcome. Victory is the word N-I-K-E. N-I-K-E, and that's the word victory. And faith is the victory that overcomes the world. That's death to self. So this is talking about casting out self out of us. That's the demon or the daemonion itself. The Jews called them demons. The Arabs called them genies. The Celts called them fairies. The American Indian called them totem. And totem means kinfolk. They had a totem pole. And they had a wolf and an otter and an eagle. And whatever they had on there, if you were of the family of the wolf, you didn't kill a wolf because he was your guardian angel. And that's what the Greeks called them. They were leading you to good fortune. And if you remember that movie, Clash of the Titans, and the gods are sitting up on this parapet, not a parrot, but a parapet. That's a balcony in heaven looking down upon Perseus saying, we'll give you this gift and this gift. And they were distributing fortunes to him. That's what the word demon means. And we're talking about ghouls. And they go, the demon or the ghoul is driven into desert places where there's no water. Now, when the stronger of them comes, overcomes him, he taketh from him all the armor wherein he trusted and divideth his spoils. What's the armor where he trusted? That self trusting in the riches of this world. He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. When the unclean spirit or self is gone out of a man, he walketh in dry places like the ghoul. Oh, where does the scapegoat go? He's driven into dry places, out in the desert where there is no water. And what is the living water? Jesus tells the woman at the well in John 4. It's the Holy Spirit. I'll give you living water and you'll never thirst again. When you go into dry places, this is talking about, as a young baby believer, you come into the truth and you don't grow and you don't learn, you'll end up going back into the world into dry places. That's what Hebrews, the 6th chapter, says. If after we have been, we come to truth and the Bible says we need to put away these basic principles, not put them away, but going unto perfection, to maturity. And if we don't go on to maturity, we as believers will end up, it's impossible for those who are once enlightened and learned the truth, if they don't go on unto perfection, you'll end up falling away, you'll put Christ to an open shame, and you'll crucify him afresh in your life. If you don't grow, we've had many people leave here because they would not grow. And when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, seeking the spiritual Sabbath, resting in all the things of God, but he doesn't go on to growing. And finding none, he saith, I will return unto my house whence I came. And when he cometh back to his house, back to himself, he finds it swept and garnished with no sin there. Then goeth he, and he hasn't grown, and he taketh to him 7 other spirits more wicked than himself. Boy, when you fall back out in sin and you're a believer, you get into some evil. I know that because I've done that when I was younger. And they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. This is talking about a person that doesn't mature, just like Hebrews, the 6th chapter. Let me get back to the ghoul thing. I don't know. I didn't mean to get into this much. In the ghoul also is a desert-dwelling, shape-shifting demon that assumes the guise of the animal, especially a hyena. It lures unwary people into the desert waste or abandoned places to slay and devour them. That's the same thing the 11th chapter of Luke is talking about. Isn't it amazing how these things all tie together? The creature also preys on young children, drinks blood, the Eucharist, steals coins, eats the dead. What's that talking about? There's a world of dead people walking around that are vessels of wrath, fitted to destruction, and they're wanting to devour us. Satan goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. That word devour means to drink down your blood. Then taking the form of the person most recently eaten, there is a world of vessels of wrath wanting to devour the children of God. And they are spiritual, evil spiritual ghouls wanting to devour us, aren't they? You can't get away from this whole picture. In the Arabic language, the female form of the ghula is G-H-O-U-L-A-H, and the plural is ghilan, G-H-I-L-A-N. In colloquial Arabic, the term is sometimes used to describe a greedy and gluttonous individual. And the scripture says in Ecclesiastes, the fool folds his hands and eats his own flesh. You can't even watch The Walking Dead without something, boing, it just went, whoa, I've got to look at ghouls. And I connect it right straight with the Bible. And then they go into ghouls in popular culture, but it's a demon out of the ancient world. And those were the gods of the ancestors, and that's South, isn't it? And it goes into these vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, they hate this message and they want to devour us, don't they? They hate us, want to crucify us, destroy us. I don't think I'm going to read the rest of this. I got to get on with the message. But this has to do with the message we're talking about, doesn't it? What is this thing about, I've got 15 directions I can go right now and I don't even know which one to take. Let's go back to where we were. Isaiah. And it'll have to do with ghouls, or demons, or genies. That's what Israel went after when they were a nation, when they were a nation under kings, from 1 Samuel to 2 Chronicles. 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles. They were going after Baal, which was a demon, which was an ancestor, which was a fairy, which was a... And there were good and bad demons, good and bad fairies, and good and bad genies. They were just your great-great-grandmother. I've said before, they said that your great-great-grandmother would come and inhabit your body and either lead you to good or bad fortune. They would lead you to money or break your leg or get you fired. It was a good and bad demon. That's why you see in the cartoons, even in a Bugs Bunny cartoon, you see a little demon on one shoulder and a little so-called angel with a halo, which is the sun god on the other shoulder, and that's an oxymoron, isn't it? Or it's an oxanamoron, one of the two. It's just crazy. We got it in our cartoons. And you'll have a good and bad demon. And the little angel will switch from year to do right, and the other one is whispering here to kill the cat or something, you know. It's just astounding to me. And it all goes back to Israel for 500 years under kings. Everything in the Bible, everything about the end of time, everything in Israel, everything about the World Trade Center, everything about the land of Israel, everything about the Iraqis and the Arabs, and everything that went on in France, and those terrorists over there killing all those people. It's all of it's about what Israel did during that time period. Every bit of it. It's like, I can't just give somebody a sentence and say, this is what it's about. Explain to me, Mary used to come to me years ago and say, explain to me, I don't more than two or three sentences. Now, I want you to explain to me this, and I'd say, and she'd ask me the question, I'd say, I can't answer that. You got to give me more than three sentences. You got to sit and listen to me for 30 minutes so I can just give you a sketch. I can't just answer this. Everything that was going on over here, if you don't watch all the time, you're not going to understand what I'm saying. Watching once in a while, somebody hear one message, you said this and that's not true. Watch the whole series. The World Trade Center coming down, that attack the other night in Paris, the attack on those cafes in the Middle East, the Palestinians wanting to attack Israel and wanting to become a state. Name any situation in the Middle East or in the world that has to do with Islam. Islam and Christmas and the Masons and Halloween and Easter and Mardi Gras are all part of the same picture, along with everything else that's evil. Babylon mothered it all. Revelation 17 and 5 says so. So everywhere you go, if you start with Babylon, and you go to Roman Catholicism, it's all fire worship. You go to Islam. You go to the South Sea Islands and a volcano god. You know where the word volcano comes from? It comes from the word Vulcan, the fire god of the ancient world. Oh, that's what Israel was going after, wasn't it? And God rained fire from heaven and devoured the sacrifice in the 18th chapter of 1 Kings. Vulcan comes from Baal, or Bol, Kahan. And Kahan is the word priest in the Hebrew. I keep saying it's the word Cohen here in America. That's the variation of it. And Mickey Cohen was a gangster. He was a hitman for Bugsy Siegel. He's going around offering sacrifices, killing people. He was supposed to be a priest, Mickey, and of course he finally got killed. And Kahan means priest. Bol is a form of Baal. And priest of Baal comes from Kana, or it's a variation of priest, Kahan, Kana, C-A-H-N-A. This is what Mr. Hislop tells us, and he was a reformer that believed in predestination, and he preached in England and in Scotland, and he was a godly, righteous man. I've got some books by him, besides the two Babylons. So this comes from Kana and Baal. They shortened it to Kanabal and shortened it to cannibal, which is a devourer of human flesh. And that takes me immediately to eat flesh and drink blood of the Roman Catholic Eucharist. And that's where Vulcan comes from. So volcano comes from Vulcan and those gods in the South Sea Islands. The Bible says, no, it don't matter where you go. Ghouls, Vulcan, throwing a virgin into a volcano to appease the gods so they could have crops. Wherever you go, you can connect all of it together. That's why when Israel went after Baal in the grove, that was nothing but the sun and the tree god. That's amazing, isn't it? You look at the flag of the... The land of the rising sun was what? Was Japan. I kept hearing about the gods, the ancestor worship of the Japanese. And if you go into a Japanese house and say, would you like to accept Christ? Oh, yes. Give me a statue of him. I'll put him on this shelf with my 700 other gods. People are like, all you got to do is accept Christ. No, God has to change your heart. You have to become a new creation. It has to change your whole thought processes. So Israel goes after all of the, it matters not where you go. You can go to Hinduism. You can go to Buddhism. The Buddhists were called Svastis. That was the Buddhist sun worshippers, and they had a swastika. Where can you get this, Jim? McClintock and Strong. Real simple. Hastings. Internet. Look up swastika on the internet. The priests of Baal wore tall white pointed hats and white sheets. worshiped the flaming cross on Lady Day in the ancient world. Sound like a Klansman to me, doesn't it, you? If you're black in America, you celebrate Christmas after you hear this message, you're crazy. The Klan and Christmas come out of the same thing. And the young black men in America have been hoodooed. They've been told by Islam that Allah is the same thing as Jehovah, and it's not. Allah was a tree god. Did you know that I had a guy used to come here, and he was a drummer, and he was taking courses out at Vanderbilt. He said, ran across to Arab out there and said, Jim, he said the same thing you said. Well, I got it from some source like that. He said that before Mohammed started Islam around 535, something like that. He's born in that time period. He said, this guy said that Muhammad simply amalgamated all the ancient sun and tree gods in the ancient world to a one god system, to the monotheist system, one god. He said he amalgamated all these ancient gods of the ancient world into one Islamic system. And when you see Israel going after the oak tree in the Isaiah the 44th chapter, as well as Jeremiah 10, they make a god. The Bible says they warm themselves with this wood, this tree, that they cook with it, and they make a god out of it, and they worship it. And the word oak is the word A-L-L-O-N, and the root word is A-L-L-A-H. It was the tree god. It all goes back to the same thing. Israel was a nation under kings from around 1096. You say, Jim, you keep teaching them the same subject. The Bible is the same subject wherever you go, from one end to the other. Well, Israel kept going after these gods, and God scattered them all over the earth. And he says, by the same token, I'm going to bring you back at the end of time. I'll gather you from all the nations where I send you. Whenever I see a word like that, the way I study is very elementary. Very elementary. I take a concordance. I make a copy of that page. Sometimes I'll just take it like this. Sometimes I'll go through every word. I'll go down through there and I'll say, God is the mountain of God's holiness. Mountain stands strong. I'll go down through here and I'm studying mountains. And I'll go through and I'll look at a whole bunch of these verses. I'll look at three or four or five of the words and see if it's going to fit what I'm studying. And I'll go through and read these verses just one at a time. I'll read them sometimes when we're watching Ultimate Fighting. And Sheldon said, you're over studying when you're watching the fights. I said, yeah, I can do that. Real easy. And I'll be reading them, and I'll check them off. And they're over there sitting there watching the fights going, I'm going. I'll read while I'm doing something like that. And then I'll go through, and I went through, and I wrote down gather. And I wrote down where God's going to gather Israel back. He said he was going to do it. Over there in the 36th chapter, he said, I'm going to scatter you, and I'm going to call you back. I'm going to regather you. Well, then you go into history, and the reason he scattered them was because they were going after these gods, and he kept saying, I'll send the sword, the famine, the pestilence, and he sent it for 500 years, and he said the final judgment will be the beast. This is all a huge mosaic is what it is. If you'll stay with me a couple of 3 years, you'll begin to see the Bible from one end to the other because I'll preach all the way through it. Won't I? I love the Word of God. I love it. I love knowing about it. I love talking about it from one end to the other. But you say, but Jim, you naturally understand it. When I was 17 years old and I started trying to read it, I didn't understand anything. Daddy's reading three verses and shouting, telling the story for 45 minutes. God, I don't know where to even start. And I'd read some, go, boy, that's hard. That's boring. I got to force myself to go back and read it. A day or two later, I'd force myself to read. I say, I can't understand this. I'd force myself to read, and then all of a sudden I'd start hitting something. I said, oh, this is the same thing it said over here. And this is repeating. I'll gather you, I'll scatter you, I'll scatter you, I'll scatter you. So I go into a concordance and print out the scatter page, And there's a whole page full of scattereth. He that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Babylon scattered Israel, scattered southern Judah. Assyria scattered northern Israel. It's not like it's hard, it's tedious. You want to study, you got to get tedious. Okay? You can't get it easy. Now, though, you can't, I know some of you can't study that way. If you'll come here, I'll lay it out in front of you, all right? I'll just lay it out. All you got to do is come here and take notes. If you can, watch it. If you love something, you'll get into it. I wanted to know the Bible more than anything I wanted in life when I was young. And the only way you're going to learn it is get tedious with it. If you'll do that with one paper, I've got, I'll gather you from the people, Ezekiel 11:17. I'll bring them back, Jeremiah 31. I'll gather you from all nations, Jeremiah 29:14, Ezekiel 37:21. I'll gather them from all the countries, Ezekiel 20:34, Ezekiel 20:41. I will gather you, Ezekiel 22:21. I will bring them back, Ezekiel 34:13. It goes on and on. But he did scatter them, and they haven't had a nation for 2,600 years. So I'm going to study some history along with it. I'm going to study and find out, what is this all about? Set that right there. Well, I know Israel came back and became a nation May 14th, 1948. And the people that got angrier more than anybody else, and the only reason they became a nation is because God touched the heart of Harry Truman and caused him to pressure the world at the end of World War II to declare Israel a nation, because 6 million of them had been killed. But the reason we're having the problem over there is because prior to them becoming a nation, from 1517 to 1917, they were ruled by the Ottoman Turks. And I've given you a paper on all the kingdoms that they, the empires they've been ruled under. They have been ruled, misruled, slaughtered, and butchered since 586 B.C., when God carried them away captive because they had gone after all these sun gods, which were ghouls and genies and demons. And it astounds me. People don't pay any attention to what the Bible is saying, and they don't look up words. Proof that there's a biblical proof that the pagans called their gods demons. There's a biblical proof. It's the best proof you can find in Acts the 17th chapter. Look at that. They called their gods demons or daemonion. They will tell you they called them daemonion. Paul is traveling on his second missionary journey. He gets to Athens. Here's his second missionary journey. This is exactly where he is. I don't know how to say all this. I got a million things in my mind. I said I got all these things going on in my head, and I want to say them all at once, and I can't. Here he is on his. Here's his first journey. Comes up here to Antioch, goes down to Cyprus, comes up here, hits the coast of Pamphylia, hits Antioch, Iconium, Derby, Lystra, and Derbe. He's stoned and left for dead at Lystra. Comes back, and then he gets ready to go to the second missionary journey at the end of chapter 15 of Acts. Well, he takes off. Him and Barnabas have a falling out, and he gets up here and picks up Timothy and Titus. He takes Titus with him up here at. He meets Timothy at Lystra. He goes on up here, crosses, leaves Turkey right here, which is Asia Minor, goes over here to Greece. And he gets up here to Philippi, which the book of Philippians is written to, and Thessalonica. And he comes on down here, and he gets to Athens down here. Now, at Athens, they have what you call Mars Hill. Mars Hill was a place where they set up all their gods, just dozens of gods. And there's a bunch of Epicureans, which are philosophers of these pagans. And there's a bunch of Stoics there. I'm not going to go into Stoicism and Epicureanism right now. But he runs into them, here in Acts, the 17th chapter. And they will tell you themselves that they believe Daemonion, which is our word demon, that's their ancestors, it's their gods. They'll tell you right here. The pagans will tell you. And right here in chapter 17, verse 16, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city was wholly given to idolatry, which came out of Babylon, which is the same system that Israel went after. You say, how do you know it was the same system? Well, because Babylon mothered it all. You're going to find kinship between volcano gods, Hindus. Hitler was a sun and tree worshiper. There's a book called The Twisted Cross. It's talking about the swastika. What was Hitler doing with swastikas, which was an ancient symbol? It was an ancient peace symbol. It was the Big Dipper. Gosh, we get into everything, don't we? The Big Dipper is the swastika. Let me stop and just stick it on the board real quick. The Big Dipper is actually the swastika in four phases. March 3rd. Here's the swastika. All right, and then you got, and the Big Dipper is seven stars. God tells Amos, tell Israel to seek him that maketh the seven stars in Orion. Don't seek the seven stars, seek him who makes it. Well, they were seeking the seven stars, and of course, Pleiades also had seven stars. I believe that's two witnesses. Well, it's seven stars, that's what it is. And on March 3rd, and every 3 months, they would check the Big Dipper. Here was the spring over here. This is Ostara. This is Lugnash here. These were eight festivals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We've got that in books, and they wanted to get the Big Dipper from the summer. They go into summer, and then they would get over here to Samhain. That's October the 31st. They knew they were going into winter, the pagans did, so they said, we've got to get through this hard, cold winter. They didn't have Krogers and didn't have ways to cure anything, smoke some of their meats and stuff. But they were terrified of going through these sub-zero weather here in the Northern Hemisphere. So they said, somebody's got to turn this wheel of the year or the Big Dipper and get it back over here to the spring so they'll have crops. It was all about food. That's all it was about. And they said the god or the goddess that turned the wheel of the year was the Queen of Heaven, and who is unfamiliar that's ever been in the Roman Catholic Church with the Queen of Heaven being the Mary of Roman Catholicism. And 600 years before Jesus was born, Israel was going after the Queen of Heaven in the 44th chapter of Jeremiah and offering drink offerings to her and cakes. Kavan is the word cake, and it means sacrificial wafers. Sounds like the Eucharist to me, doesn't it? That's 600 years before Jesus. Now look here in this 17th chapter. And Paul sees the whole city given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons. See, Paul didn't go to the synagogue to listen to their halakha. He went to dispute with the Pharisees and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics, which were pagans, encountered Paul. And some said, what will this babbler say? Some, he seemed to be a setter forth of strange gods. The translators knew that these people were talking about their gods, and the word gods is the word D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. Evidently, the translators knew that the pagans called their gods by the title of demons. So this is proof right here. Even Paul will tell you again over here in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. He will show you as God is causing him to be inspired by the Word of God that their gods were called demons. Their demons were their ancestors. When you study McLinock and Strong and Hastings and a whole bunch of other books I got in my library, you'll have an absolute understanding that the demons were the gods. So were the genies. Genies is just a title for demons in another culture, the Arab culture. If you believe in demons, you have to believe in genies. And the sun gods, which were these demons, their birthday was December the 25th. I did a message years ago. Demons are born on December the 25th. And they were. Not Jesus. Goodness gracious, that's because the winter solstice came on December the 21st, the longest nights of the year, and they thought the sun was burning out. I can't explain this in two or three sentences. You understand that? I know y'all understand it. I'm saying it to the camera. Don't look at a sentence or two I've said and say, oh, that's not true. Listen to the whole story. I was in the hospital when I had my heart attack, had heart surgery, and they had me on, what's the painkiller? I can't think of it. Morphine. Had me on morphine. Boy, that's like that makes you think you're somewhere off in another world. I could see string hanging down from the ceiling, just millions of things of string, and I saw Cricket, my dog, and Cowboy running up under there and running to the bathroom in the hospital. I thought it was Cricket. And I saw this, and I had a picture of Adolf Hitler hanging on the wall. I don't know why Adolf Hitler, but there was one there. And I saw, and I was thinking about the things I had learned in the Bible. And I was thinking of the Bible as a one big, huge picture that I think of when I think about it. And I thought, if I can get out of this bed, and here I am on morphine, if I can get out of this bed and I can paint this picture, I can explain the Bible to everybody. And I was going to want to get out of bed and get me a great big canvas and paint this picture on it. And I was thinking this way. I couldn't get out of it when I was on morphine. I couldn't get out of thinking about this. Anyway, he says, what will this babbler say? He said it seemed to be a set forth of strange gods. Look over here in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. Paul says that demons are the gods of the pagans in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. Amazes me, but if you go to the original text, and all through this 10th chapter, he's talking about the 10th, in the 8th chapter, in the 10th chapter, he's talking about offering, these people offering sacrifices to the idols. And he says here in, I don't know where to start here. Verse 18, behold, Israel, after the flesh, are not they which eat of the sacrifices partakers of the altar? If you partake, they would offer sacrifices, these pagans at Corinth. And Paul says in the 8th chapter, these are not really gods. And then they would take these sacrifices that they offered to their gods, they would take them down into the marketplace, and they called this marketplace, they called it the shambles. You find that word in verse 25. Whatsoever is sold in the shambles, they would offer these sacrifices to their gods, and they would take them to the shambles in the marketplace. It was little huts in the marketplace, so they would sell the meat that had offered to one of their gods. And Paul said, those are not gods. All they did was cook the meat for you. You can eat it unless somebody's an unbeliever or somebody's a weak believer and they don't understand you partaking of that meat. That's why he says in verse 25, whatsoever is sold in the shambles, that eat, asking no question for conscience' sake. For the earth is the Lord, earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. If any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, and you be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before you, eat, asking no question for conscience sake. But if any man say unto you, this is offered as a sacrifice to idol, eat not. Not for your conscience, for the sake of that man that is weak, and he's a believer. Don't partake of something. And that's talking about us in life. Don't partake of something simply because you say, well, there's nothing wrong with that. I will eat. When they put Valentine's candy on sale, if I like chocolate, I'll buy a sack of it. If I see somebody around that thinks, oh, you're buying Valentine candy, I won't buy it. You understand what I'm saying? You got to be careful what you do in front of people. But if any man say unto you, this is offered in sacrifice to idols, eat not for his sake that showed it, for conscience sake, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Conscience, I say, not for your conscience, but for the man who says, I'm weak, and it looks like that's wrong. Watch out what you do in front of people. For why is my liberty judged of another man's conscience? I'm at liberty to eat, but I got to watch out for his conscience. Back up to verse 18. Behold, Israel, after the flesh, are not they which eat of the sacrifices, partakers of the altar? When God's people ate of the sacrifices, God's priests ate of the sacrifices from the altar, they had a flesh hook. They would dip it down into this altar. Whatever they were offering, in the morning they offered lamb. If they were offering something to purify the priesthood, it was usually a young bullock. They'd take a flesh hook and down there, and they partook of that altar. The pagans ate of their altars and ate human flesh from their altars. They were Kahanbels or cannibals, cannibals. That's where the eating flesh in the Catholic Church comes from. Then he says, but I say that these things, that the things which Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice unto devils. And he's saying these people that go to these, they go over here to the temple of Aphrodite and offer sacrifice, they're actually sacrificing to Daemonion. The word devil there is Daemonion. They're sacrificing to their ancestors, which are demons. You see that? Paul is verifying that demons are ancestors, and it was the gods of these people. I just want you to stop and think about that. They were sacrificing to devils and not to God. I would not that you should have fellowship with Daemonion, with people that are distributing fortunes. And then he says, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord. What's the cup of the Lord? This cup is the New Testament in my blood. Testament, last will and testament. Drink of a cup meant to undergo death. You can't die to self. What he's saying here, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of Daemonion. Since Daemonion means to distribute fortunes. Look here. Let me make it real simple. Cup of the Lord, drink of a cup meant to undergo a death. That's death to self. Cup of devils, cup of Daemonion, is fulfilled self. It's distributing fortunes to self. God's not saying, I'm not going to permit you to drink death to self and fulfill self. He's saying it's not possible to fulfill self and crucify self at the same time. Can you? That's why you can't fellowship with the world, fulfilling self and dying to self at the same time. It's not only forbidden by God, it's not possible. You can't be up and down at the same time. You can't be on top of the building, on the bottom of the building at the same time, can you? You can't fulfill self and die to self at the same time. Now, where am I? Goodness, I got a million things to say. We're talking about Israel went after the same thing. God says, when I bring you back, I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. I'm going to take your stony heart and give you a heart of flesh. I'm going to write in fleshy tables of your heart truth, and Israel will come back and they'll obey God. They became this nation. Like I said, from 1917, because Israel was scattered, what they did over here as a kingdom, because they were scattered, all the time they're scattered, when you leave a house abandoned, somebody's going to move in, aren't they? That's what happened to Scott down there. He's 20, 40 miles into the jungle, they built a church down there. And they go down there and preach on the weekends. He'd preach in Puyo. And then he'd go down in the jungle and preach on Sunday afternoon. Scott, I love you, brother, very much. You're going to learn. You can't walk away and leave some people and go off somewhere. Mary said, coming to church. She said, it's kind of like you pastoring here and saying, I'm going to go on evangelism on some weeks and go out here. I'll be gone 6 or 7 weeks. Somebody's going to try to come in here and take over, aren't they? It's hard enough to keep the people together here in truth, in a group. That's why Paul, when he would go to these churches, he'd say, Timothy, you stay here at Ephesus. They need a leader. Titus, you stay here at Crete. They need pastors. I will evangelize. I'll go around, organize the churches, and I'll put you guys in charge. Oh, by the way, there's a couple of preachers over here at Ephesus, Timothy, Hymenaeus and Philetus. They preach a doctrine that eats like a cake. Watch out for them. They're young preachers. Oh, Phygellus and Hermogenes is over there too. They're young preachers. Look out for them. Alexander, he's made the word of God of none effect. He tried to stand against me with these people over here at the Temple of Diana. Look out for him. Beware of Alexander. He's a preacher at Ephesus. You know the big problem I've ever had here at Grace and Truth Ministries with young guys who wanted to be preachers? That's all the problem I've ever had. I don't have a problem with Lily, who just is a sweet little lady and don't want to hurt nobody. She don't want to take over. It's amazing. And if you think the most recent group that left is the only ones that's left, no, I've had a bunch of that. And if you think this is the last time this is going to happen, it's not. Just stick with us and we'll learn, okay? Now, the reason all this happened in the Middle East, it is about the land. And oil is a method that it's bringing this about. And gosh, we could talk about the oil all day long. We're not going to do that. It's about money and power. Now, we are where we are. We're talking about Israel being scattered and coming back. We talked about Ezekiel, the 37th chapter. That's the Valley of Dry Bones. This one guy wrote us and said the Valley of Dry Bones was what he said it was. That guy that said the earth is flat. Said some crazy thing. Well, that happened in the Puritans or something. I'm going, huh?
About the moon being, sun being 5 miles away.
Sun was 5 miles away. The guy said the earth was flat, said the sun was 5 miles away. Sounds like the vision of Fatima. And the vision of Fatima where these little kids saw the Virgin Mary. Yeah, sure. It's always little kids, you know. It's not somebody grown and mature. And they said the sun was spinning around and round and round. It came near the earth. If the earth gets a degree off, it's going to burn us up. If we move away, it's going to freeze us. We're exactly the orbit God wants us in. And they said the sun is spinning around and around, got real close to the earth. Well, okay is all I got to say to that. Now let's go back over here to Isaiah. Doesn't the world have some wild imaginations? Remember, the Bible says when they built Babylon, the mother of harlots, they said, let us make us a name. Let us make up our own authority. Once this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Once a man says, I'll make up my own name, my own doctrine, my own shem is the word name, my own authority. I'll get involved in all of this imagination of Hinduism, Buddhism, and free will, and Baptist, and Roman Catholics. The Baptists are Roman Catholic. They walk down the aisle and accept the Eucharist. They accept Christ. That's where it comes from. Now, go back to Isaiah. We see the Valley of Dry Bones. The Bible says, Ezekiel, preach to these bones. You can't bring them alive. What I will do, when it says they're very dry, It's like the great scholar said, it means they've been dead a long time, 2,600 years. They've been out in the sun, dead. God says, when you preach to the dead, my dead elect, best illustration throughout the Bible of preaching to the dead bones. We don't know who they are. We just preach to the world. God said, I'll bring my elect from all over the four corners of the earth, bone to his bone, the foot bone connected to the leg bone connected to the knee bone. That's where the valley of dry bones. It's about the whole house of Israel coming together. But if you notice, God says, I will put them together into one body, but they have no breath in them, and the breath is the Holy Spirit. That's the truth. Then I'll breathe life into them. You preach to them, I'll bring life to them. That's the dead elect. Well, that's when he gathers them back. He says, at the end of time, I will bring, over here in Ezekiel 37, he says, take one stick for Joseph, which is the stick of Ephraim. Now, when the Mormons say that's Joseph Smith, that is so stupid. The stick for Joseph is the stick of Ephraim, the second born of Joseph, the 11th son of Jacob. And he says, take one stick for Judah, which is the southern kingdom. This is the two southern tribes. Joseph is the 10 northern tribes. When you see Joseph after he's dead, that's talking about the 10 northern tribes. When you see Judah long after he's dead, that's the two southern tribes. When you see Jacob, then the Bible says in Micah, the first chapter, about the fifth verse, I think, it says, what is the transgression of Jacob? What is the transgression of all of Israel? Is it not Samaria? Samaria is the 10 northern tribes. Who brought Bel and Grove into Israel in the 10 northern tribes? Was it not Ahab when he married Jezebel in the 16th chapter of 1 Kings? That's exactly who it was. I'm sorry I can't explain this in three or four sentences, but I can. So you go back. Wasn't Samaria the reason? This is the 10 northern tribes. This is what I've been talking about. Samaria. When Ahab marries Jezebel, here is Israel. Let me hit an eraser. The reason Ahab marries Jezebel, she's the best-looking woman that's real close to his castle in northern Israel. I guess. She must have been good-looking because he had his choice. She couldn't have been ugly. And here's what we call Lebanon up here. Here's Israel down here. He had northern Israel. He had southern Judah. Two tribes, 10 tribes. This was the transgression. Samaria was another name for northern Israel. Well, the castle of the prince of Tyre was just above the border of Israel. Mount Carmel was up here in northern Israel, and Jerusalem is down here in southern Judah. Well, Ahab didn't have his castle and his ruling in southern Judah because that was Jerusalem. He had a castle, he had his house and his ruling place up here in northern Israel, just across the border from Tyre, which we call Lebanon. And somehow, somewhere, some night, he runs into this woman, Jezebel. She brings her gods down here into southern Judah. Her father was Ethbaal, which means with Baal, and he was a priest. When you look at McClintock and Strong, you look up Ethbaal, it'll tell you that he was a priest of the Ashtaroth and Baal of Babylon over here on the Euphrates River. And the two systems in the ancient world that propagated this sun and tree worship more than anyone else was Babylon and Tyre. That's why the prince of Tyre is equated with Satan himself. It's nothing but a let us make us a name system. And that's in Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, when the prince of Tyre is equated with Satan, and he's, the Bible says he was in the garden with God until iniquity was found in him. God made Satan with a glitch in him, and he wanted him to occupy Babylon and wanted him to occupy over here. All of this evil was ordained by God in a systematic system. So it married down into Israel. And how did Judah get it? The daughter of Jezebel and Ahab married Jehoram, the king of southern Judah, married his son Jehoram. Married Jehoram, daughter of Ahab. This is the story. It's just a story. So Ahab and Jezebel's daughter, Athaliah, married into southern Judah and took her gods with her and tried to destroy all the seed royal of southern Judah. When her husband Jehoshaphat died, her husband Jehoram died, when her son Ahaziah died, she tried to kill all the inheritors of northern Israel, and she got them all except Joash. But the scepter will not depart from Judah. Now, the same story of Israel coming back, becoming one in the hand of God at the end of time, Ezekiel 37, is the same story of Isaiah 11. Go back to Isaiah 11. Isaiah gives you an account. All right. Got so many places to go. Isaiah, 11th chapter. I'm not going to review this. I'm just going to say a couple of things about it. You say you can't say a couple of things without reviewing it. Well, I'll try not to, because I've already preached on it. I've already taught on it. At the first of the chapter, it's talking about a stem. The stem of Jesse being the branch, being Christ. Branches in capital letters, capital B. That's Christ ruling all through here. And it talks about a spiritual mountain of God. It talks about wolves, which are false teachers there in Matthew, the 7th chapter. And in the 10th chapter of John, the parable of the good shepherd, the wolf comes in. The hireling is left with the sheep, the man who preaches for money, and he allows the wolf to come in and scatter the work. Scatter is the verb form of scorpion, and scatter is false. Scorpions are false teachers. You dwell among scorpions, Ezekiel, be not afraid of their words. And he's in the 2nd chapter. And then the bear and the lion and the leopard are here. We know that's Babylon, Persia, Greece. This is all very figurative language. And then he says, this wolf, this bear, lion, and leopard will not herd in my holy mountain anymore in verse 9. Well, it has to be figurative language because they've never had a rash of lions, bears, and leopards, and serpents coming in Jerusalem, and nobody ever wrote in history that they had all these bears and lions and leopards and serpents coming there and killing all these people in Jerusalem. That never happened. But you did have Babylon, Persia, Greece, and false teachers there, wolves. Then he says, in verse 10, we talked about the holy mountain of God is Jerusalem, Zion. This is Zion, Jerusalem, opposing the Babylonian mountain, which is a proud mountain, which God says, and has destroyed all the earth with her pride, and I'll make her a burnt mountain. You see the burnt mountain over there in Revelation, the 18th chapter, the destruction of Babylon finally. You got Babylon being destroyed over here in the Old Testament, in Isaiah, Babylon's destroyed over here, Isaiah, the 13th and 14th chapter. You've got Babylon being destroyed, Babylon destroyed. And these are all different accounts of the same event. Isaiah 13, 14, you find the 14th chapter there, the Bible refers to Belshazzar as Lucifer. Lucifer's not Satan. It's only Satan in the sense he's inhabiting Belshazzar. He's the leader and the final leader of the fire worship. Destroy that night when Cyrus comes in the 36th chapter of 2 Chronicles. Kills him. And you have Babylon being destroyed in Isaiah, the 44th and 45th chapter. This is the same time period, the same events, a different account. You also have Babylon being destroyed in Daniel, I said the sixth chapter several times. I meant the fifth chapter. Sometimes I'll be thinking of Daniel in the lion's den in the sixth chapter, and I mean the fifth chapter. Y'all understand that, don't you? Sometimes I get all these things going on in my mind. Now, the fifth chapter is the destruction of Belshazzar when he sees the handwriting on the wall, and Cyrus comes in and says, "This is your last day to live." They kill him right there on the spot. That's the end of the Babylonian Empire. Babylon ends here in 13, 14 of Isaiah, 44 to 45 Isaiah, fifth chapter of Daniel, and Jeremiah, the 50th and the 51st chapter. That's all. This is all different views of the same event of the destruction of Babylon when Cyrus comes in and destroys them, and the Persian Empire takes over and begins to rule. And they're still involved in sun and tree worship. Now, down here, I want to finish this chapter, because it is a sister. The rest of this chapter is sister to the 37th chapter, Israel coming back into one nation, Joseph and Judah. One stick for Joseph, one stick. Look at that real quick. Ezekiel, the 37th chapter, and then I'll come back over here. I want to match it up, and I want you to see it. So he preaches to the dead bones, flesh upon his flesh, there in verse 8. Bone to his bone, verse 7. And that's where the old Negro spiritual, the foot bone connected to the... once in a while, I'll get the foot bone connected to the hip bone. Boy, it'd be a funny looking man, wouldn't it? Then said he unto me in verse 9, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind being a picture of the Holy Spirit, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, upon Israel, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them. This is Israel at the end of time, being gathered together back into one nation. They were split in two. When Solomon allowed his wives to keep all their Ashtaroth, which were all the female deities, tree deities, Christmas trees, God split the nation, 700 wives and 300 concubines. He said, I'm going to take the kingdom from Judah and give it to northern Israel. Northern Israel was led by Ephraim. Ephraim became the inheritor of northern Israel long before this split. Ephraim became the inheritor of northern Israel in the 48th chapter of Genesis, when Jacob took his right hand and laid it upon Ephraim, the hand of blessing, crossed his hands. And Joseph said, but father, Manasseh is my son. He gets the inheritance. He said, not this time. So Ephraim gets the inheritance. God splits the two nations into two nations. The reason we know the end of time can't be far away, Israel is one nation now. But they're not going to heaven because they are one nation. They're going to heaven because they'll come to Jesus Christ, and I believe there'll be a remnant of Israel believe the truths that I teach. They're not going to believe Billy Graham's gospel or Charles Stanley's gospel or Kenneth Copeland's gospel. They'll have to. They already know Christmas is pagan. The Jews know that. They believe in the Old Testament, they believe in the sovereignty of God, that they were God's chosen people. They'll have to come to truth through Jesus Christ. No man comes to the Father but by me. Now, let's continue reading here. Where was I? Then he said unto me in verse 11, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. It's not southern Judah and northern Israel. It's the entire nation come together in one body. It's the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried and our hope is lost and we have no hope, not without God preaching to them. But they're going to have to join us in spiritual Israel, the church. We are cut off for our parts. Therefore, prophesy unto them, say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves. This is very figurative. I'm going to call you back into the land. I believe there has to be. And it's all over the fire worship, and that's Christmas. Constantine brought it in the church and renamed the fire system Christ Mass. And cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. I'm going to gather you back. He says that all through the 36th chapter. Just look up the word gather and scatter in your concordance and go down the line and read those verses. You won't believe how. You know, I've never heard anybody talk about Israel scattered, Israel being brought back. I've never heard anybody talk about Baal in the grove in the Old Testament being the sun and the tree worship and all of the systems of the world coming out of the same system. If Babylon mothered at all, they're all going to have the same characteristics. They all had a virgin-born son in all the systems. Tammuz was virgin-born. Adonis was virgin-born, said to be born of a virgin in a cave near Bethlehem. How do you know that? Man, I got so many books to read, I can't read them all. And ye shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves. That's figurative. They've been dead a long time. O my people, and brought you up out of your graves and shall put my truth, my spirit. Is that any different than the Holy Spirit in the New Testament, which is the truth? John 14, 15, 16, John 15, 26, John 16, 13, 1 John 5 and 6. The Spirit is the truth. Is that any different? No. And ye shall live. The dry bones are going to come alive. Israel as one nation. And I shall place you in your own land. Well, the land belonged to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in Genesis 17 and Genesis 28. And the Palestinians believe, and the Arabs think they own the land because they lived in it 400 years prior to 1917. 90% of the people in the land were Palestinians. It depends on your viewpoint as to who you think the terrorists are. Those people that are willing to crash planes into World Trade Center and die for their cause, they're not crazy. They really believe in what they're doing. Well, what's the answer? Well, there's no answer. There'll be distresses of nations with perplexity. The funniest thing that happened that night after that sad attack on Paris and all those people died, the funniest thing was all those talking heads got on TV. Well, the CIA and the Homeland Security, and I'm a senator, and we need to do this. Nobody's going to do anything, are they? Frederick Murphy and Mauricio and Howard and Margie Charlton and the gang came over the house Friday night. Frederick Murphy is big, tall fellow, great big guy. And he's in the military over there. He was in the first deployment to Afghanistan. He was in the first attack. And he has got to be deployed in January, February. And he told me the other night, he said, a friend of his was talking to an Arab, to a Muslim. He said, you can't believe anything we say. Our religion, Islam, tells us to lie to everyone for our cause. So everything we say to you is a lie. When we say we're your friends, we're not. That's what Islam tells us to tell you. And I said, Frederick, if they let 10,000 refugees come in here every year, we don't know who's terrorist and who not. He said, that's right, we don't. He said, they put their children out in front of our convoys when we're going into a town to stop them, and that's when they start firing on us, and they don't care if they kill their kids or not. He said, there's no principle in it. I said, does Obama know this? He said, no. He just won't face it. There's no such thing as fighting an enemy when you don't know who they are, because they will sacrifice their children. They'll take their brothers and say, put this bomb on you, go down here into the marketplace, blow it up, and you'll go to heaven and you'll have your 70 virgins. One of those Islamic people died and they went up there and their heaven, they saw George Washington and Ben Franklin, and they said, I thought I got 70 virgins. No, 70 virginians. Dumb. Now, let's go back here. 14. I'll put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and shall place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I am the Lord, Israel, and have spoken it, and performed it, saith the Lord. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, moreover, thou son of man, take one stick, and write upon it for Judah, the southern kingdom of the two tribes led by Judah and Benjamin. And for the children of Israel, his companions. Children of Israel is the 10 northern tribes. When it mentions Israel, after Jacob is dead, it's talking about when it mentions Israel after the split. After the split, Judah is a term for the southern kingdom, the two southern tribes, Israel is a term for northern Israel. So when it says Israel, here's talking about the ten tribes. For Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, which verse was I in? Oh, 16. Moreover, thou son of man, take thee one stick, write upon it for Judah and the children of Israel, his companions. Then take another stick and write upon it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim. Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, not Joseph Smith. They don't even pay any attention to this. They don't know anything about the Bible, do they? Well, this is Joseph Smith, the Mormons say. Idiots. Just stupid. It's the stick of Ephraim, the second-born son of Joseph. And for the house of Israel, his companions, join them one another into one stick, one nation. That's never happened before May 14, 1948. Understand that? And they shall become one in thine hand when the children of thy people shall speak unto thee, saying, wilt thou not show us what this meanest, what meanest by these? Say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I will take the stick of Joseph, northern Israel, ten tribes, which is the hand of Ephraim, and the tribes of Israel, his fellows, and will put them with him, even the stick of Judah, and make them one stick in thine hand, and the sticks whereupon thou writest shall be in thine hand before their eyes, and say unto them, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will take the children of Israel from among the heathen where I've scattered them in 586 B.C., 722 B.C., northern Israel, whither they be gone, and will gather them on every side. I'm going to gather them back and bring them into their own land, and I'll make them one nation in the land upon the mountains of Israel. That has never happened until May of 1948. What about when Jesus was here? Only southern Judah was back from the captivity. Northern Israel was called the ten northern tribes of the lost tribes. They never had the decrees to come back. So this is prophecy of the end. This goes along with Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21. Those are prophecy chapters in the New Testament where Israel will come back. Luke 21, 24, they, the Jews, will fall by the edge of the sword, be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the Gentile rule is over. The Six-Day War, June 5th through June 10th, 1967, for the first time in 2,600 years, Israel, got Jerusalem back. They threw the Jordanians out in that Six-Day War. That's why we have to be close to the end of all things. And I've never seen the church so apostate. I've never seen people come to grace and truth and just fall away so easy. Somebody will disagree with me on one point and say, you're low down and you're a low life and you're this and that. Well, gosh, just because I disagreed with my algebra teacher on one point in a math class don't mean I'll throw my algebra papers away. I disagree a lot of times with McClintock and Strong, but don't mean I don't like them. I disagree with Alfred Edersheim from time to time. But he's a wonderful teacher. He did. Died in the 1800s. Had one fellow come here, if he found one person in one book say anything that disagreed with him, he'd throw the book in the trash immediately. I'd have to throw away my whole library. I'm not going to do that. You have to glean through books, pull out the facts, and leave the opinions behind. Have you learned that yet? Learn it. You have to exegete. Now, where was I? All right. I will make them one in the nation, in the land upon the mountains of Israel, and one king shall be king over them all, Christ. And this is talking about the church. It can't be just literal Israel. With all these miraculous wars, the War of Independence, 65,000 Jews are attacked by 45 million Arabs. Not possible to win, but they did. The Sinai War of 57. The Six-Day War of 67. The Yom Kippur War, they should have lost in 1973, but they didn't. The fact that God has miraculously preserved them, to me, it looks like the bones are just being put together, but there's no breath in them because they don't believe the truth. And I don't believe all of Israel will come, but I believe there'll be a remnant that joins us in believing Christ in truth. I hope we can be a part of that. Neither shall they defile themselves any more with their idols, nor their detestable things, nor with any of their transgressions. Sounds like the fulfillment of Daniel 9:24. To make an end of sins, make a reconciliation of iniquity, to anoint the most holy, to do these 6 points, make Israel, make God's Israel, which is the church. Church means called out. They were called out of Egypt. We're called out of this world to live righteously. A Jew is not outwardly, but of the heart. Circumcision is of the heart. They'll have to join us in believing truth. And I'm not going to read the rest of this. Let's go back over here before I lose time. Do I have any time, Mike? Let's go over here and finish up chapter 11. You'll see the same thing happening in chapter 11, all because Israel went after this Christmas system, that Constantine brought in the church arena in the Christ Mass. Look here in verse 10. Now, verse 10 is proof that this is talking about the church. They shall not hold herd in my holy mountain. What is the holy mountain of God? What's the holy mountain of God?
Zion.
We are come to Mount Zion, there in Hebrews 12:22. Mount Zion, heavenly to Jerusalem, the church. Israel is spiritual. It always has been. And in that day, verse 10, chapter 11, in that day when the Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome, the blind, barren leopard, and the false teachers, the wolves, when they don't hurt God's holy mountain, in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which is Christ, which shall stand for an ensign, a sign, a same thing as uth, it's the word ness, means a sign or a beacon, and of the people, and it shall... To it the Gentiles shall seek. Excuse me. Verse 9 proves that it's the church. Let me read verse 9 again. And shall not hurt in my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as waters that cover the sea. That is one of the most powerful things said in all the Bible. The earth shall be full of his knowledge and glory as waters that cover the sea. It will be the church all over the world. That'll be the mountain of God. Israel certainly has been scattered through the world, but they're not Israel till they come back. We're called to gather together in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ throughout the world into one body. And then he says, it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people. When's the first time he recovered them?
Babylon.
Huh?
Babylon.
Well, they didn't come back from Babylon. Only about 50,000 came back. Most of them stayed in Babylon, and God measured out 70 weeks on them because they didn't come back. The first time he recovered his people is when they came out of Egypt, brought him into a nation. They didn't come back from Babylon. They stayed scattered. They're still scattered until May of 1948. The first time he gathered them was when he gathered them at the hand of Moses to lead them back to the promised land that he'd given to Abraham. The second time is at the end of time. And he says, the remnant of his people which shall be left from Assyria, from Egypt, from Pathros, it's a district of Egypt, from Cush, an area of Egypt, from Elam, which is part of Persia, from Shinar, which is lower Mesopotamia, down on the Euphrates River. And you got to realize, back then, where Israel was scattered was throughout what we call the world, the civilized world at that time. That's where they were scattered. Of course, they ended up in the United States, and that's covered here too. Look. They ended up in Russia. They ended up all over the world. And from Shinar, and from Hamath, which is Syria, and from the islands of the sea, that would be everywhere in the world. United States would be an island as far as that's concerned over there. From the islands of the sea, That's the Gentiles. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations, a sign, a flag, a beacon, a signal, and assemble the outcasts of Israel. What's the outcasts of Israel? That's Israel being scattered all over the world. They were cast out of Israel. Outcasts of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah. Judah was scattered in 586, weren't they? They were dispersed. The dispersed comes, we get the word diaspora. The diaspora, that's an official title for the scattering of the Jews all over the world. We get the word dispersed from that. It comes from the word dia and spore. To spore something means to scatter seed. When Israel went after all these idols, God had a farmer that he called Nebuchadnezzar. And he came in and scattered his seed throughout the world so he could call the Gentiles. That goes with Acts 2. To pour out of his spirit on all flesh of the Gentile flesh, red, yellow, white, black, and brown flesh. All people, all men, a part being the whole. So he's scattered Israel by his farmer. That's a part of the picture too, to get the word all over the world. So in Acts 2, when they all come back speaking those glossolalian dialects, that they can take the word back of the gospel or the resurrection to the Gentiles all over the world. And Peter said, it was by my mouth that the Gentiles first heard this preaching of the gospel. Peter stood at Pentecost and preached the truth to all these Jews from every nation under heaven, and they were speaking all these dialects and glossa, not Pentecostal tongues, so they could take the reason for the tongues. Tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, to them that believe not. And 1 Corinthians, the 14th chapter. What's the only sign to them that believe not? A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. There will be no sign be given but the sign of the prophet Jonah. That's that Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights, then resurrection. What was preached at Pentecost was the resurrection. That was so the Gentiles could get the word from all over. And gosh, that takes us to another subject. Look at verse 13. There was always envy between Judah and Ephraim. They were fighting all the time, even at war with each other. Then you'd have Ahab, a wicked king, run down to Judah and tell Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat, I'm going against the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad. Would you come and help me fight? I'm a heathen and you're a godly man. And that's what got Israel in trouble. What brought paganism to southern Judah was a godly man fellowshipping with a wrong man in northern Israel. Ahab would run down to Jehoshaphat, good man, a godly man. Jehoshaphat had the Bible read, had the Word of God read throughout all of Israel. He was righteous. He had one problem. He hung around with the wrong people. Don't think you can go to somebody's house on Friday night and eat steaks with them when they hate predestination, they hate Christmas, and it's your in-laws. You can't. They'll get you dirty. That's what Haggai, the second chapter, says. It said, if you take a clean thing in a garment and a priest is coming to the temple to offer a sacrifice, and if he touched some unholy thing that's not to be offered with that sacrifice, wine or something else that's not a part of the sacrifice, and it's unclean, does it make the unclean thing clean? And Haggai said, no, it makes the clean thing dirty. When you rub elbows with the wrong thing, and Israel rubbed elbows with everybody that was around them, with the gods of Egypt, with the gods of Moab, with the gods of Ammon, and they started worshiping their gods. And the next verse says, so is this people Israel. They're dirty because they rubbed our elbows with the wrong people. You can't have somebody in your house. You can't have one of your kids sleeping around and say, well, that's just the way kids are. And I'll say, hey, hit the road. Eric got a little rebellious one time when he was about 19. He wanted to come and go as he pleased. Mary said, you don't come and go as you please. She came down hard on Eric. And she said one day, she said, get out, hit the road. And Eric left. About 2 weeks later, he called and said, kid, I come home. All I got is crackers and peanut butter. I said, tell your mother. You come home, behave yourself. Of course, he's 47 now, and he's having to deal with two little boys now. He's going to learn that, isn't he? Eric's one of the good guys. I love my son. I love him very much. But you have to cut off fellowship. You're going to get dirty. Come out and be separate and touch not the unclean thing, and I'll receive you. Israel messed around with those gods. They wanted to be friends with everybody. You can't. Where was I? The envy of Ephraim shall depart, and the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off. Ephraim shall not envy Judah, and Judah shall not vex Ephraim. They're going to become one nation in my hand again at the end of time. We must be close. But they shall flap on the shoulders of the Philistines. Wow! Where is Israel flying upon? What are the Philistines now? The Gaza Strip? And is Israel flying upon them? Oh, yes, sir. They said, back off, Buster. And the Gaza Strip is the land of the Philistines. It's on the southwestern corner of Israel. Here's Israel. Here's Israel. The Gaza Strip is right there, the land of the Philistines. That's where Gaza was. That's where all the cities of Gath was, Goliath of Gath. That's the old land of the Philistines right there. And are they flying as one nation upon them? Yeah, they are. This has to be at the end. They shall flap on the shoulders of the Philistines toward the west. Isn't that west of Israel right there? It's in the western, southwestern part of Israel. They shall spoil them of the east together. They're going to spoil the land of Moab. Moab and Ammon is Jordan. If there's anybody that's terrified of Israel, it's Jordan. Everybody else is separated a little bit from him. Remember King Hussein of Jordan? Married an American woman. He was walking around like, we want to be friends, Israel. Not Saddam Hussein, King Hussein. He was kind of a pansy king. They're sitting right next door to a nuclear power. They're trying to behave. Jordan usually tries to behave themselves until some of these wars that came up recently. But they're not so quick to jump on Israel. That's Mighty Mouse sitting there amongst a whole bunch of cats. They shall flap on the shoulders of the Philistines toward the west. They shall spoil them of the east together. They shall lay their hand upon Edom and Moab, Jordan. And the children of Ammon shall obey them. They better obey. They've gone in with some of the attacks. But Jordan is not the instigator usually of this. The instigator is Syria up here. It is... what's his name? I can't think. Huh? Hassad. It was Hassad's father. Hassad is a crazy man, but his father was nuts. He was behind all of the organization. It's Syria that really started this. That's what IC stands for. IC's Syria. Iraq, Syria. It's Iraq, Syria. What's the other initial stand for? Iraq, Syria is what those two stand for. And and of course, Iraq has got Al-Qaeda. ISIS is the dissidents of Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda is barbaric. But ISIS said, you're not tough enough. We're starting our own outfit and we're going to kill all the world. And we'll die with it. You have to believe in what you're doing to die with it. Don't you?
Huh? The U.S. trained them.
U.S. what?
Trained.
Yeah, the U.S. trained them, yeah, behind the scenes. We've trained, we supported Al-Qaeda when, in the 80s, we supplied them with all they needed when they were fighting Russia. We subsidized them, gave them all these weapons, training, everything else. It's a crazy thing that's going on over there.
They got so powerful.
Yes, they are powerful. Then he says, they shall lay their hand upon Edom and Moab. The children of Ammon shall obey them. That is Jordan. Southern Jordan is the land of Moab. Northern Jordan is the land of Ammon, the Ammonites. Israel got their sun god Molech from Ammon, northern Jordan. They got their sun god Chemosh from southern Jordan, which was called Moab back then. Remember, Moab and Ammon were the two sons of Lot. They're cousins, their first cousins to Israel. They were the two sons of Lot by his incestuous relationship with his daughters, because they thought, well, maybe our father's going to have the seed in him to be the Messiah. So Jordan is nothing but cousins to Israel. The Lord shall utterly destroy the tongue of the Egyptian sea. The Sinai Peninsula. It will be Israel that takes that over. And they did, until they conceded in a peace treaty to give it back to them. Took that in the Yom Kippur War of 73. And with the mighty wind shall he shake his hand over the river, and shall smite it with seven streams, and make men to go over dry shod. And there shall be a highway for the remnant of God's people, which shall be left from Assyria, like as it was to Israel in the day that he came out of the land of Egypt. Make a highway in the desert for Israel. Make a highway. There in Isaiah, the 40th chapter. The way out of Babylon, this takes me to another subject, baptism, doesn't it? And the baptism of repentance. John the Baptist came preaching the doctrine of repentance, which is make a highway, and prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Prepare the way. That's quoted out of Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Make a highway in the desert for Israel to come back from Babylon. And that's the baptism of repentance. And that's repenting after you've been taken to Babylon because of all your apostasy, going after these sun gods over here. Make a highway and come back and rebuild the temple of God, which temple you are. Y'all realize how many subjects go along with this? I may bring these books back next week. I was going to get back in Christmas. I've got a whole slew of books in my library. This is a catechism of the Catholic Church. One young 17-year-old said, how do you know that the Catholics believe in eating Jesus? Well, you buy a Catholic catechism. It's real simple. Go down to Barnes & Noble and buy one. And what's really amazing to me, the Catholic catechism will tell you the last thing that Jesus was eating. They won't tell you that it was crackers and grape juice. They will say he was eating the Passover. They know the truth about that, and the Baptists don't know it. And I've got this book on the myth of Mary. It'll tell you why Constantine brought this fire worship into the church. He thought he was going to lose, and this is history. And then I've got this book. I got another one here. Oh, and Constantine... I've shown this before, and I gave you copies of it. I've given you copies of it. I'm out of time. I might say this again, but it's got in the front of it this map of all these barbarians, Scythians, Samaritans, Celts, Huns, Visigoths, Ostrogoths, Vandals, Franks, Angles, Saxons, Vikings, coming from all over the world. Rome was ruling all these countries in the Tan. And all these barbarians are coming, and they thought, and Constantine thought he was going to lose the empire to these barbarians. And the Visigoths crossed the Danube River, and they put them to tax them, and the Visigoths attacked Rome and finally overthrew Rome. But he had already instituted Catholicism into the church. And this is a book called The Barbarians, a time life book. And then I've got this book on word origins. Dictionary of Word Origins. You look up hocus pocus, and they'll tell you it comes from hocus corpus eum fili, presto changeo. And that's what they utter when they presto changeo the cracker into the literal body and blood of Christ. And they get the word hocus pocus, and that's what the magician says. And magic, means the science of the magi, or the wise men of Babylon. I don't know. What do people want from me? I just give them information. One guy left here said, you use too much extra biblical information. What? Now, what? How you answer that? Yeah, I do. I want to study the history, study the culture, the customs, the idioms, the metaphors. And I got this book, The Battle for Christmas. You can buy this. Stephen Nissenbaum, professor at the University of Massachusetts, tell you all about pagans' origins of Christmas and what Christmas was in America in the 1800s, and it wasn't nothing like it is now. It's heathenism. The Baptists didn't have nothing to do with it. And here's a book, Fox's Book of Martyrs. And I went online last night and pulled out the Inquisition. You got the Spanish Inquisition. You got the Portuguese Inquisition. You had the Medieval Inquisition. You had all these Inquisitions that went over a 700-year period. And the Catholics have hidden how many people they slaughtered. One writer said they slaughtered 60 million people, and they said, we only slaughtered 150,000 here. Well, what's the difference? Tortured them. You get that out of Fox's Book of Martyrs. You go online, look up Inquisition, Spanish Inquisition, Portuguese Inquisition, Medieval Inquisition, the Roman Inquisition. And they had what they called an inspector general. And you go to the old movie, The Conqueror Worm, with Vincent Price, that came out in the late 50s. They don't say it's Catholicism, but they're going from house to house killing heretics. And he's the inspector general. And that's what they had in the Roman Inquisition. And they're killing people. And it doesn't say Catholic. Get the old movie, The Conqueror Worm. The inspector general is going around and said, you're a heretic, and taking them out and stretching them on the rack and killing them and peeling their skin off. You got it everywhere. You got it in cartoons. It's everywhere. It's everywhere. It's kind of like Ray Stevens said about Santa Claus. He's everywhere. Remember that? Oh, me. I didn't even go where I was going to go. I don't know what to do. Just throw it at you and let you try to assimilate it in your mind. Well, let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. Help us, Lord. Give us strength. This is getting so tough this day and time. The church is falling away. They're pulling off and pulling away from truth. And I don't know what to do other than what I'm doing. I'll keep doing it, Lord. If everybody quits, I'll say, I'm keeping on. I get depressed. You know that. But I'm not quitting. I hope the church will come to that conclusion. We're not quitting. We're going to keep going straight ahead. Lead us to your elect family. Open up doors for the ministry. Supply every need. Lord, we want to stay on all these TV stations and a whole bunch more and reach the elect family. Fight all of our battles. Supply every need. And we're going to trust you to do exactly what you want to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Me. I don't know how to say it all. I didn't say enough.
What part of right here in Isaiah were you talking about?
What one?
I didn't hear it. You were talking about Isaiah, and you said right here you were talking about the part of the Bible that said these are the ones right here that were the...
This is the Philistines, and it's also the land of, it's the Gaza Strip.
Yes.
And they were going to fly, and Israel's going to fly upon the Philistines, and that's what Israel is doing, which is to the west.
So what, you were in Isaiah?
Isaiah, the 11th chapter.
That's what I was trying to find. Okay.
Look right here.
Yeah.
I got it right here. Look here at Hocus Pocus. Look at that. Right there. And they're not doing it out of religious. They're just saying, hey, this is where it comes from.
Yep.
Hocus Corpus Eum Fili. Some of them say Eum Fili. Some of them just say Hocus Corpus Fili.
Connie is staying away. What these people do?
I love you, brother.
I love you dearly. I'm going to get my license.
You can still get that.
You probably find it online somewhere. It's amazing. We got this thing everywhere.
Google is amazing.
Look here. This is utterly... I went online and pulled this off last night. I thought, I knew the Inquisition is actually what killed the people in the Fox's Book of Martyrs. And they go into what countries? I won't know how many countries the Romans conquered because they didn't conquer the barbarians. And so I went in there and got all of that. Inquisition, it'll tell you amazing stuff, they say. They'll bring out the Albigens family, the Waldenses. The Waldenses were in the 1200s. The Albigens were in the later, about 400 years later.
Iron Maiden.
Yeah, Iron Maiden, yeah. Yep. And they'll say things, it's just, it's astounding.
Some of those rock bands understand all this stuff.
They know
and they
something.
They love evil. Yeah. They're right into it. It's just.
But the thing is, so are the Baptists.
Yeah.
Baptists are not any different than a rock group.
Yeah, Iron Maiden ought to go over and play at the First Baptist.
Iron Maiden is not as dangerous as a Baptist preacher up here at First Baptist.
That's for sure.
At least we know who they are.
Yeah.
You can go online and pull all this stuff out of there. They'll tell you the most amazing, amazing things.
Now, Wikipedia, the problem with Wikipedia that I've had and I've seen is that in Wikipedia, you can go on there and write whatever you want, and they'll take that as part of the definition. And,
that's right.
You know,
yeah.
So it's right. It's a lot of hearsay in Wikipedia.
Well, I understand that, but I've studied other books that verify this.
Yeah.
That's the point. I don't believe everything I read.
Yeah.
But I believe it when they're talking about the Albigenses, because you're going to get that out of Fox's Book of Martyrs. You're going to get it out of these encyclopedias. What I do is a match up one thing with another. Mm-hmm. I don't just believe everything I read, but do I believe that? Yeah. And I can tell when I'm reading a real radical right winger. I can always tell that.
And there are some
because they get more shallow in their accusations. The ones that give you just pertinent facts is right down the line. I can better believe that than some guy that's mad at the Catholic Church. You can tell the difference. I've got one in here that I can tell he was just grinding an axe.
Yeah. Too many drugs.
But I believe that. I believe what, and I've read
is this
it in.
A good one, or did you cast that?
Probably is good. But I know how writers are. I don't believe everything everybody writes.
We've been in the music business. You're pretty much in that business. Don't believe anything plus 20%.
You can't believe anybody, can you?
I love you. Connie's love to you, too.
She's been sick, too.
For 2 weeks now, she keeps teaching. Do you know a parent put their children with scarlet fever in school knowing
that's crazy.
I have people come to... I have people lazy. I have people come to... One parent to stay home.
I bet.